guys, it's Liam. I'm back with another YouTube video. Back in the M140i again. Today I'm going to be running through a few of the features that I like about the car. I'm going to first start off by going through the five sort of things I like in terms of it being a driver's car, so more of the performance sort of stuff. Five of those over here. And then because it's my daily driver, and it might be for you too if you're looking at buying one, I'm going to run through five of the features that I just like in general about the car, sort of the everyday living with it. But let's be honest, you're probably buying it because it's a performance car, so we'll jump into them first. If you stay to the end of the video, I'm going to run through a couple of bits that I dislike about the car as well, just to help you make an informed decision. Stay tuned to end to see those. There's not many, to be fair, but any car there's probably little niggles and bits and pieces you don't quite like about it, or that you think BMW could have done better.
Right, so just a little cut scene here, guys, just show you Auto Trader, just showing you that you can pick a M140 up for between 18 and 22k with a good spec on it, and for what you get for the car, it's an absolute belter of a price.
Just want to say a big thank you as well to anyone who's liked or subscribed to my channel, liked any of the videos. It's a massive help and I really do appreciate it. If you do watch my videos and you're not subscribed yet, please hit the subscribe button. It's just down below there. And I also see my link to Instagram, which is on my channel, which I sort of upload daily car content to. Really trying to push both at the minute. So any help would be massively appreciated. Be sure to drop me a comment after you watch the video. Let me know what you thought to it. And any improvements you think I could make. I'm always open to hearing sort of constructive criticism and feedback. So yeah, but without any further ado, we'll jump into the video. Cheers, guys.
Yeah, so first thing I want to do is just talk about the engine, which is the main reason you're probably buying one of these cars in the first place. Absolute monster of an engine. Don't skip a beat. So you can look online for yourself, all the reviews, absolutely bob on. So it's got a 3 litre straight six, a BMW with a B58 engine. Literally type B58 in online, you'll find plenty of reviews on it. 3 litre straight six, 335 brake horsepower, 369 pound of torque, I believe. Obviously putting all that power through the rear wheels, so but yeah, absolute minter of an engine. Another reason it's so good is it's really highly tunable, so a lot of people will stage 1, 2, 2+ these. I think even on a stage 1 remap you can get sort of 100 brake horsepower out of it, or just under, maybe with a new air filter in, performance air filter in. And then you start talking stage 2 and 2+, you're getting up to the sort of 460 sort of brake horsepower mark. So yeah, fantastic engine, can't say a thing bad about it. Going from the engine, moving swiftly onto the exhaust system. So there's two exhaust systems you can get as standard with this car. There's the sort of stock and the standard exhaust you get, and there's the M Performance. Now mine's just got the stock exhaust, so calipers, 4-pot caliper, big brake kit with a 340mm discs on the front, which are vented, standard, they're not drilled or grooved or anything, but you can upgrade them. And then the rears, we've got 2-pot caliper on there, 345mm disc on the rear, really good stopping power, which obviously you need. And you've got 335 horses to use, so yeah, really good. And like I say, you get plenty of options to upgrade them with the sort of drilled and grooved ones, and loads of different brands of pads you can get to sort of customise that and improve the braking. But for me, if you've not sort of modified your car and you're just on standard brake horsepower, these absolutely bob on.
Obviously, this is the ZFA auto gearbox. A lot of people may disagree and they'll prefer the manual. I do understand where you'd be coming from with that. Three pedals, manual gearbox, and 335 brake to put down. I can see the fun factor in that. But I really like this auto gearbox, or semi-auto, which you can go across. I mean, just not on a minute, so I can't do it. But yeah, it's really snappy, really quick, never misses a beat, sort of never lets you down. It doesn't really matter which mode you're in. It's really good. And obviously you get the two flappy paddles up there as well to use, which just gives it that sportier sort of feel, in my opinion. So yeah, really like this gearbox. I'm glad I went for the automatic.
Alright guys, I'm just going to bring you on to my last sort of favourite thing about this car in terms of it being a driver's car, and that's the fact that it is rear wheel drive. Got plenty of tread on the tyres at the minute, which I don't really want to waste. But yeah, obviously this is rear wheel drive only, 335 brake at the rear wheels. You can easily drift this car going around corners. On that note, I will just say, be careful. Easily to get a few hairy moments with this car when coming out of a bend, especially if it's a bit damp on the road there. I've seen plenty of videos online with these cars being crashed, mainly because people underestimate the power when they're putting it down out of a bend. But yeah, absolutely banging car to drive, especially on a twisty country lane like. And yeah, sort of brings me to that last sort of thing I like about this car in terms of being a driver's car. So I'll move on to the next couple of bits.
Guys, pretty much all the features in terms of being a driver's car that we've gone through. So if you are looking at getting one of these cars, hopefully that's helped you, because that'll be the main reason you're buying one, to be honest. And then you've got the exhaust system, which I've mentioned as well. You can easily have the resonators removed from the stock exhaust, which £150 or something like that. Quite a lot of garages do that now, and it only takes a couple of hours for a garage to cut the resonators out, replace it with a bit of straight pipe. It's completely legal and it improves the sound of the car massively. I sort of think it should come out like that from standard, really. But obviously all the emissions and sound regulations and stuff like that, and then there's plenty of aftermarket exhaust you can put on as well. So I think pretty much every exhaust company will make one for the M140 and then pair it with that 3-litre engine. It sounds fantastic. So right, we're going to move on to the other features I like about the car, and sort of the everyday living. So we'll jump into that.
But the first thing about the sort of living with this car every day is, with it being obviously a hatchback, the smallest sort of class that BMW do, you might think it's going to be really small inside, but I've had quite a few hatchbacks and I think this is probably the biggest one that I've had. In terms of space inside, so this is how I have my seat set up usually. As you can see, fairly laid back, but not ridiculous. Plenty of leg room, and I am 6 foot, so that's how I have the front set up. And then I'll just show you the back, so what space there is. So there's quite a bit of leg room there still, as you can see. And I've got, there's three kids that sit in the back of here, so plenty of room for them. So obviously I mentioned that I'm 6 foot, or maybe just under, but you always say you're 6 foot if you're 5'11", don't you? Yeah, plenty of leg room and knee room is all right. And obviously got the child seat there. So he's got plenty of room, although he does kick the back of my seat, which is really annoying. And then just bring you to the boot. So boot space, I think it's about 380 litres capacity. But yeah, handy little storage compartment there. That opens up there if you want it to. I'll just store my microfibers in there, to be honest. And then bit more storage in here, not much, but away. A little bit more storage next to the battery there. Quite a hefty battery, to be honest. Anyway, yeah, decent bit of boot space.
Yeah, just gonna quickly talk about the next thing that I like about the sort of everyday living, the M140, so it's the reliability, to be honest. Obviously I'm starting with a B58 engine, solid engine, not had any problems with it whatsoever. I've got the car on 17,000 miles and it's now done 34, I believe, just under 34,000. You probably wouldn't expect any issues, to be honest, at that mileage, but I've had plenty of cars that have had issues, but this one absolutely bang on, nothing whatsoever. So
yeah, so just coming on to the next thing I like about the sort of everyday living with the M140 is the iDrive system. So as you can see, I've got the ProNav in here, which is the bigger screen, a better quality display, and yeah, I ain't got a bad word to say about it, really. Never had any problems with it. It's always sort of, it's pretty responsive, pretty quick and easy to use. Literally use the little dial next to the gear lever and then scroll through using that. Does everything you need, really, and probably will still rival some of the infotainment systems you get in new cars today. So it's really good. Vehicle information up. See stuff like your tire pressures, oil level. I need to measure it. It's because I've been sat with the engine off, otherwise it'd show straight away. Controls, so if you've got any warnings or anything, or anything it wants you to do, so it's telling me that my key battery is running low and needs replacing soon. The battery needs replacing. Service tells you that all your sort of serviceable items are okay. Tells you roughly when you might need to think about getting a service. So it is good. It does give you quite a lot of information what you might need. So yeah, really good system. And obviously media wise, you can link your phone up to it. It's got DAB, digital radio, and then like I say, Bluetooth connectivity, link straight up to your phone. And that sort of brings me on to the next sort of feature I like about it, is the sound system. So you get the Harman Kardon sound system, which is the best sound system I've ever had in a car, and I've had quite a few, so I think it's better than the Bose systems that you get in Audis. And then sort of previous cars I've had, I've sort of upgraded to Alpine
the sort of stereo system and speakers, and I think this is better personally. So you get little sort of speaker subwoofer behind the iDrive screen there. You get the upgraded tweeters, the Harman Kardon says there, obviously both sides. And then you get uprated speakers in all the door, sort of door cards, and there's some in the boot as well. So really good quality sound. And I'll just play you a bit of the music from it now. Let it just fall out, give a little bit of, with a little bit of, let it hang all out with a little bit of, and a sprinkle of it. Let it just fall out, I like it when you, little baby, make it.
Obviously, next we're going to come to the overall styling of the M140i, which I really like. I think it looks quite classy, a little bit understated, which I quite like about my cars, especially if I'm going to be using it every day. We've got the classic sort of M140 styling, so we've got the canards at the front there on the bumper. We've got the grey mirror caps, which I quite like. However, I have seen you can upgrade them to the M style in the grey, which I think looks quite nice as well. So thinking about doing that. Got the gloss black dual slotted grills on there, which aren't standard, which I put on. And then the red sort of crash bars at the back, which I've done a video on. Go and check that one out if you wanna see how to do that. We've got the M140 alloys, 463M, I think, might be wrong. Someone will correct me in the comments if I am. The gloss black surrounds on the windows. Let's put that little M badge on there. And then the rear, we've got the grey sort of diffuser, which it looks alright. I think I'm going to change it for a gloss black sort of slotted diffuser. We've got the twin tailpipes, and that's about it really compared to like a standard one series. Like I said, not a lot of difference, just a few subtle hints showing that it's an M140i. Just cleaned it as well, it's raining. Look at that. Didn't do that bit very well. Still got some soap suds on there. But yeah, we'll cut to the next bit.
Guys, so pretty much brings us to the end of the video. Hope you've enjoyed watching it. Hope you've learned a few bits and bobs, and hopefully helps you make an informed decision on buying an M140i. Hope the decision is you are going to buy one, I should say. It's a really fantastic car. There's not a lot I dislike about it. Really solid build quality, amazing performance, and really good sort of space for a small hot hatchback. Obviously at the start of the video I stated that I'll give you a couple of the dislikes, what I've got with this car, just because everything isn't always golden and perfect, is it? So a few little bits. Number one, if you are thinking about getting one of these cars, make sure that you can afford to run it and maintain it properly. It's not obviously all about the monthly payments if you're getting it on a PCP or HP or a loan. There's a sort of maintenance cost, insurance cost, and fuel costs behind it. So little insight, obviously I've had this car for a year and I've gone from 17,000 miles to 33,870. I'm not going to do the maths on camera, because that would be far too embarrassing, but it's a lot of miles in a year. So I travel to work and back, pretty much 50 mile round trip, and I do that for sort of 6 days. So I tend to use, doing those sort of miles, I tend to use about £250 a month in fuel, and I normally just put E10 in, to be honest. Obviously a lot of people recommend to put high performance fuel in. I don't feel the need
to. That brings me on to the next sort of running cost, is the insurance. So before I had a 1 series, I had a 116D, with the mileage that I sort of declare, I think I put about 15,000 per annum or something like that. Social domestic pleasure and commuting, I was paying about 250 on that. This is pretty much tripled, so I'm paying just under £700 a year on the insurance on this. And then obviously costs of repairing the car, should you need to sort of repair anything, and the servicing and general sort of maintenance and upkeep. So I had a quote for a service from BMW at 350 quid, which was just an oil interim service, which of course I didn't do. I have found a local to me, a BMW specialist garage, which use all the same sort of machines and parts, equipment as BMW, but it was half the price. I paid 150 quid for an interim service on this. So yeah, definitely worth sort of hunting around for a, if you have got a sort of German car specialist or BMW specialist garage in your area. Definitely look at taking it to them rather than actual BMW. Next little thing is, I don't think it's a massively common issue. Well, I've not seen that it is anyway. The top of the doors on the 5-door model, at least, have a little rubber seal on them. Occasionally, it can sort of make a little squeaking, rubbing noise. Usually, when it's been raining and then it's sort of drying out, so there's one little thing to be aware of. You can probably rectify it quite easily with some sort of coating, but I haven't tried it. I'll let you know if I do try it, if it's any good, on a video. But yeah, that's another little thing just to be aware of. And then the only other thing to mention is, occasionally, and I have seen this on forums, I think it's quite a common thing, occasionally with the stock exhaust system, I think it's the, it could be something to do with the exhaust flats when you're putting into sport plus. Occasionally on start up, on cold start, there's a little rattle. I know a lot of cars develop it and sort of tend to keep it. Mine's done it once or twice. It's not done it for a while, touch wood. But yeah, just another thing to sort of bear in mind. You can repair it. It's just one of those little common faults, I think. And there we go, guys. It brings me to the end of the video. Hopefully, I've given you some valuable content and something you can take away from it, which I'm always trying to do. If you have enjoyed it, be sure to hit subscribe, like the video, be sure to comment. I always look forward to hearing any feedback that you've got, and it'll help me obviously improve future videos. So, yeah. I won't be offended if you didn't like it. Hit the dislike and drop me a comment saying why you didn't like it. But obviously I'm new to this content creating stuff, and I do believe that every time I am improving the videos. So we'll keep going, keep pushing, and stay tuned for the next one. Cheers, guys.